Now I would like to invite Prof. Sulafa Ali to give us an update on how establishing the cardiology program in developing the limited resource country. Of course, Sudan, one of the big issue I think nowadays, limited resource. So Professor Sulafa, she is an interventional cardiologist, pediatric interventional cardiologist at Sudan Heart Centers. She's had great experience in rheumatic heart disease in Sudan, and she had done many publications on this field. Prof. Sulafa and her team has done an amazing job in Sudan, particularly I think that's ongoing for last 20 years in diminishing the burden of rheumatic heart disease in Sudan. And we would like to say thank you very much, Prof. Sulafa. Congratulations. Prof. Sulafa, she has been appointed by WHO as IMRO to Eastern, Regional Director of the Eastern Mediterranean to the Sudan. So, Prof. Sulafa, without any further ado, it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Abdelazim. Many thanks for your endowment and establishing this series of webinars. This is a great job, collecting people together, connecting people who care for pediatric cardiology. I will speak about some of the achievements and challenges that we had in Sudan in the last not 20 years yet, but about 15 years. After a 25-year gap from the actual start of Prof. Abdel Munim, there was a great pause, which was really disastrous, and there was the service was almost zero for many, many years. I have no disclosures. And when we talk about pediatric cardiology program, we are talking about all these pillars, including the clinical echo aspects, cardiac catheterization, surgery, ICU, which I'm going to leave for Dr. Salah. Collaboration at all these points is very, very important. Training, prevention, patient support, and research. So we are talking about a multifaceted service. We need to work on all these. And if we look at the situation analysis right now in Sudan, it is still way, way from being perfect. We have only 14 cardiologists for a 30 million census in Sudan, with only 3 wards for pediatric cardiology, only 3 congenital surgeons, and the waiting list for cardiac surgery is hundreds. We have 6 dedicated beds only in Ahmed Gasim, and all the others are shared. Sudan Heart Center and Madani, I think most of them are shared beds. We have no ICU specialist, even at this time when the ICU, pediatric cardiac ICU consultant is mandatory personnel to care for children. And we have 3 cath labs. There are many cath labs in Sudan, maybe approaching 20 cath labs in different areas of Sudan, but only 3 are partly prepared for cardiac catheterization. We have 2 active, Ahmed Gasim and Sudan Heart Center, but the waiting lists are very long because of the small number of consultants. We have a training program fellowship since 2012, but retention rate is only 50% for that program. So these are the 3 centers, Madani, Sudan Heart Center, and Ahmed Gasim, where pediatric cardiac services are available. We have another center, which is Salam Italian Center. It's a missionary center charity by Emergency, the institution called Emergency. But this center is mainly working on replacement of heart valves, although it has a lot of facilities. So I think this center needs to be reviewed. The financing and the policies of the center needs to be reviewed by us because we want more share on congenital heart disease. If we look at the statistics of cardiology in Sudan evolving, starting from 2001, because before that, as I mentioned, there was a great pause and there was no almost nil services. In 21, it started by 2001. Dr. Al-Fatih started a clinic, and at that time, you can look here the number of clinics in 2000. 1 to 2004, and then progressively increased up to 2020. So the green is the 2020. You can see the number of clinics, echo machines, consultants, CAS operations per month, and the percentage of intervention, because when we started CAS, most of the cases were diagnostic, but recently most of the cases actually are intervention. So although the numbers might look small, but in fact, we are increasing or improving gradually, which is reassuring, slowly but gradually improving. And I think these were important milestones at, for this improvement, where one of them was sending some trainees abroad, as Professor Abdul mentioned. The West now is extremely difficult to get training post, so we send them actually to Malaysia, and the three of them, we have only one of them now in Sudan, Dr. Abdel Basit. So this is one way to train abroad. And in 2012, I think a very important milestone was the fellowship program, which although it is a graduating small number of candidates, but it has helped us a lot in the service. If we look at cardiac catheterization part, we have two labs in town here in Khartoum and one in Madani. We are doing a good number of procedures, interventions are routinely done, balloon dilatation, pulmonary and aortic valves, balloon septostomies, PDA and ASD device closures, and others like RVOT stenting and coarctation stenting are on the way. We are starting doing these procedures. And some of these are actually emergency procedures, which need a lot of collaboration with intensive care, but we still try not to let down any patient. There was a great and well-acknowledged help from our colleagues around us in nearby countries, especially Saudi Arabia. Our colleagues and friends came in missions. These missions were very educative to us. And also we made contributions to regional meetings in congenital and structural interventions in Africa and in other countries, which gave us a lot of recognition and support. In Sudan, at Sudan Heart Center, we do have a biplane CAS lab, which is actually the only one in Sudan. It is a rewarding system. And we are doing now routinely, this is a case of ASD closure in an adult. We are seeing 10% of our population are adults with congenital heart disease because we don't have the specialty in Sudan. And also we are doing some, sometimes some more complex procedures like this patient here. This is an aortogram showing a huge left coronary artery to RV fistula, which was successfully closed by a device. It was a PDA occluder, you can see it here. So we are doing some of the complex procedures, but generally we can't do what we want to do because of the lack of surgical backup on many occasions and the lack, of course, of the intensive care beds and the intensivist. So that is a great limitation for our CAS program. And regarding training, again, I'm referring to collaboration. I think all this program would not exist without collaborating with our colleagues regionally and internationally, and especially particularly in training. And we started the training fellowship program in 2012, and up to now we have like 10 batches, and we graduated 14 graduates, and but only 50% are here working in Sudan. The other 50% actually are working in the Gulf, and we are also proud of them because they help our colleagues. And but of course we look forward to more retention of staff. We have 5 now on training. And we have, of course, the curriculum of the Sudan Medical Specialization Council with all the regulations. We are inviting routinely or periodically inviting external speakers and experts. And this was a great collaboration here with the University of Alberta, Canada. This is Professor Jeffrey Smallhorn. He is one of the pillars of echocardiography worldwide. He has visited us 3 times. Successful visits, 3 workshops on echocardiography anatomy correlations, attended by a good number of fellows. These are our fellows. Actually, fellows came over from Saudi Arabia to attend these workshops because of their academic value. And in fact, he gave a lot of support when he encountered the training of we are doing in Sudan, and they gave us a support of 3D printed hearts to the fellowship program, which are still using frequently when we teach our fellows about typically double outlet right ventricle with all the complexity of that lesion. Also, we are inviting routinely external examiners. And because of the shortage of internal examiners and internal trainers, and our fellows actually are now, they are participating routinely in abroad international meetings. They are presenting international meetings and attending also conferences. This is before the COVID. Now the COVID is a blessing because we are doing all that online. We also, with the help of the fellowship program, we managed, in fact, to establish clinics in Port Sudan. That was recently clinic by Dr. Intisar, and also in Al Ubayd with partial training of the candidates in Sudan Heart Center. And we had the rheumatic heart disease center there. So we had also a clinic in Port Sudan. And in fact, the number of patients referred to Khartoum decreased with the establishment of these clinics. In fact, we are now thinking or launching a fellowship in rheumatic heart disease, which is highly needed in rural areas. We are thinking of a 9-month fellowship where the medical and the pediatric doctors or family physicians can be trained and then sent back to their rural areas. They will help us a lot in the training of rheumatic heart disease. We have regular academic activities for the fellowship program, 6 hours per week, and this continued despite of the shortage of trainers through online training. And it was a great collaboration after the COVID, because we managed to communicate with a lot of speakers. I'm very thankful to them from all over. But particularly from Saudi Arabia, our colleagues and friends, they contributed more than 50 sessions during the last 6 months of COVID. And in fact, also other societies like Congenital Heart Academy, I'm very grateful to them because their webinars helped us a lot. So the online training now is becoming a very practical solution for the shortage of trainers. In fact, we carried two final examinations using online system by Zoom, and because that was very important because of, so that was one of the solutions, I think, practical solutions for the training in Sudan. Regarding prevention and rheumatic heart disease, as Professor Abdelmoneim mentioned, it's an old disease, it's a nasty disease. In fact, in Sudan, still it is very prevalent with all the economic and political problems that happened in the last decade, or that's actually 3 decades of chaos. We had a prevalence of 10 per thousand, but actually if we go and take the echo and screen, you find up to 60 per thousand, which is a very huge number. So in 2012, we, with the help of our colleagues in Sudan Heart Society and many of our colleagues in pediatric societies, we established a program. And that program, it wasn't an official governmental program. It was actually based on charities and donations, but in collaboration with the Ministry of Health. Based on these 7 pillars, we call it Shura I Can. And actually, we started doing a lot of work in surveillance, research, integration, or collaboration, and training. And with that, writing and shouting, we didn't have money at this to start with, but it seems that it worked very well, the write and shout policy, because it did attract attention of many organizations, actually starting from the Lancet Journal up to the World Heart Federation and World Health Organization. And we are now supported a lot by these organizations, good funding, and we managed to do 6 projects in rural Sudan. We are very far from controlling this disease. Dr. Abdelazim mentioned that the disease is under control. Actually, this is all sort of starting points, and we are still waiting for official launching of such programs. But we learned a lot because we use this handheld echo screening in rural Sudan in 6 states. in six states, and these are very easy to use by even by non-medical personnel. But we trained registrars and fellows, and they went to six states and striking findings of very, very high prevalence rates in Kurdufan. For we don't know exactly, there are some genetic factors beside, of course, the being rural places away from a medical service. There are some maybe genetic factors as well. Our last project was in Al Jenin 1 month ago. And all in all these areas, there had been some awareness work, training of medical personnel, as well as echo surveillance and early treatment of positive cases. And with the fruit actually of the surveillance research was establishment of a center in Al Ubayd city, helped by all these organizations, but mainly actually by Sadagat organization is the main funder for this project, which is helping a lot by training of medical personnel, surveillance by echo screening, and awareness, public awareness. The burden of rheumatic heart disease is huge. We have a registry at Sudan Heart Center and Jafar Ibn Auf Hospital. we have good data about rheumatic heart disease, and this has been published. We have a registry with about 1,500 patients. Out of those, 70% have severe disease. It's very, very drastic, catastrophic disease. And in fact, only 7% they have access to surgery. So if we look at the fate or outcome of unoperated children with rheumatic heart disease, in 2 years' time, almost 40% had complications, including death in about 15%. So these patients, they have severe disease, they die without surgery or develop severe complications, as you can see here, and they don't have access to surgery. And this means we have to do something very, very dramatic to change the picture of that disease. Regarding research, which is an important aspect of any program, we think research is not just for promotion or for self-esteem. Here in Sudan, research is mandatory for life, for the life of people. I mean, most of our researches were on rheumatic heart disease, but it is very good and reassuring when you look at the graph here. If you take in 2003 and before, very few papers were published in the specialty of pediatric cardiology. And our reference here is Google search items. And recently, there was also very good step up of the number of publications. And I'm very proud of the fellows because they did make good contribution in writing, starting with a small number of like case reports or case series, but also participating in large projects such as the echo screening project, and by writing about the use of echo, handheld echo for congenital heart disease, and these were all published and PubMed indexed articles. And now our fellows are working on about four projects, as Professor Abdel Munaim commented that the data is lacking in Sudan. We are building a data definitely for the rheumatic heart disease. The data has been published on many occasions regarding cardiomyopathy. Also, we have a registry including clinical and genetics of cardiomyopathy already started by some publications. We also started a few months ago with the Super Heart, with the Sudan Pediatric Registry of Heart Disease, all the congenital heart disease, trying to identify patterns of congenital heart disease and outcomes, and also some other projects, like, for example, projects on isomeric hearts. Patient support should be part of the system or the program, as we know this, especially surgery is very expensive. Catheter now is free, which is a great advantage for the children and for emergencies. It is free for all, but surgery, as we know, is still very, very expensive and only 50% supported. So we have a charity It has some role in helping the families and also in some education for the families. So the challenges actually are a lot, and these are some of the challenges and some of the suggested solutions. I'm talking here about cardiology and cardiovascularization, leaving the surgical part with Mr. Salah, and this we'll discuss it later with him. But the shortage of centers, the number of cath labs and supplies also are small, and we need to increase that by making tenders with clear conditions, because this needs here the government support. We also need to increase the staff, as we are doing now, by local training, but also by training abroad, by twinning programs, which is very promising. We started some work with Saudi Arabia and Malaysia, and short visits from experts for complex lesions. I think collaboration here is very, very important. We need to work on staff retention by improving salaries and finding posts for our graduates. For complex cases, we still need to work hard to improve ICU and OR settings and train nursing and allied staff, and also work on their retentions. We, unfortunately, for neonatal interventions, we are still far away, because we do need ICU setting, NICU, early detection, fetal echo, prostaglandin, and nurse training. All that need to be improved a lot before we can start neonatal interventions. Right now, we only do few interventions like balloon atherosteotomy, or sometimes other like insertion of temporary pacing, or some rarely balloon dilatation of pulmonary valves. But all that is very limited because of the setting of the ICU. So we are doing very little because of the shortage in all this. Our patients often have to travel abroad for operations, and we did some calculations, and we think it is costing not less than $3.5 million per year, which is a huge number of huge sum of money. We do need to improve all these settings in order to be able to treat these patients locally here and help them. That's all, and thank you very much. I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Prof. Sulafa. That is really a fantastic talk. And I would like specifically to thank you for making the Sudan very well presented globally. And thank you for kind of making this connection with the other country, with the Canada, and making this kind of training program for the fellows. This is was really a great job. And I know in your last word, you said that is we're doing very little, but I think you're doing really great job. And it's really still did a big gap. And I think definitely, as we are also cardiology trainee, we got this chance to go and train abroad. I think definitely we need to look backward, and we need to use all our resources. This is for myself and for my old colleague who are listening to me now. I think everyone had a great role, and I think everyone will be able to help. Yes, we need to try as much as we can to find way to create kind of fellowships, or to help in clinical attachment, or minimal things which will make a huge difference. So thank you very much, and thank you for your team by doing this great job. So at this point, I would like to ask the panel if anyone would like to comment or to add anything to Prof. Sulafa. Okay, I think if there's no comment or question, I think we're gonna go back to the same question. I think that the question had been referred to by Prof. Abdelmunem. So there's a question regards, I mean, how late or how long can you wait for BDA closure? I mean, I think the question regards the indication for BDA closure. Can you hear me, Prof. Sulafa?
To assess the patient. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, yeah.
Yeah, you need to assess the patient very well clinically and by echo to know the size of the PDA. It could be small restrictive, for example. In this case, you can wait in infancy and try to close it as soon as possible by catheter. But in a young infant with a large PDA, it has to be closed as soon as possible. PDA is not a benign lesion, it can lead to Eisenmenger syndrome. So asymptomatic large PDA has to be closed as soon as possible, while a small restrictive PDA can be closed later on in infancy by catheter. And regarding PDA, it has variable presentations. We have closed PDA in a 65-year-old lady. It is very interesting because you never know when the Eisenmenger will start. But in general, we have to close it if it is large as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you very much. Had anyone got more questions to Prof. Sulafa before we move to the next decision? Okay, thank you, Prof.